The Goodyear Blimp has been an aerial ambassador for the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company for over 90 years. The design and building of blimps at Goodyear has seen technological improvements over the years. But the general operation hasn't changed as much. With the new Zeppelin NT, there will be dramatic changes. Join the Spirit of America, one of the last GZ-20 airships in the world, and the crew who care for her as she makes her final flights into the history books of aviation, and marks the end of Goodyear's history of designing and manufacturing their own airships. The Carson base is home to 4 pilots, 20 crew, and the public relations and operations staff that maintain the airship.
Well, you ready to go? We're about to begin our last summer tour with the Spirit of America. We're gonna be gone for about 30 days. Pretty much marks the beginning of the end of the GZ-20 Alpha models. Goodyear's been flying for many decades.
So we are getting ready to take Spirit of America on her final West Coast tour. This airship will be retiring in 2015, just a couple months from now.
Now's when we have a safety briefing in the morning before we head out. And today we're gonna pretty much go over the topics, the plans for the day, destination airport, of course. Fuel loads, all that kind of thing.
Tip off the mains and put, I think like 70 in that aux.
So pretty much top off the
aux. We're going to have a headwind, huh? As soon as you turn Santa Barbara the whole way, yeah. It's going to be strong.
The Goodyear Blimp requires an auxiliary tank to carry the fuel needed to get to its first stop, Santa Maria, California.
We can only take off with so much fuel, because if we take off too much fuel, we're going to be pretty heavy getting out of here. So we have to figure out what the ship's going to be at equilibrium. And then we only can put on so much fuel, at least with the auxiliary tank, you don't have to worry. I mean, it takes that out of the equation. That's just one less variable you have to consider.
Crew members hold the airship in position because the blimp acts like a giant weather vane and can shift in the wind.
Because we don't need speed or we don't need airspeed to stay in the air, we use helium does all that for us. So tankering fuel is not really a big issue for us. So we usually take on a little bit more than what we think we're going to need. Just take the whole thing out of the equation. One less thing to worry about.
The fuel adds weight to the airship, making it heavy. As the fuel burns off, the blimp becomes lighter, and additional weight will be added to be neutrally balanced during flight. Before the airship leaves Carson for the last cross-country event in its service life, the crew gather for a final photo to remember her by. The flight and ground crew perform last-minute checks on fuel, weight, and travel planning before departure.
After we launch the ship, we're going to make sure that everything is good. We're going to call the airship and ask him, hey, is everything in the green? He's going to say everything's in the green. Go ahead and lower the mast. From there, we're going to lower the mast. And in this trough, there's a trough down on the ground. We're going to lower the mast into there. We have our semi-trailer. Bring that around here. We're going to load all of our ground support equipment up in the trailer. Once that's all loaded, go down, we'll clean up, and we'll hit the road. Once we get to Santa Maria, we're gonna go to the airport. We'll get all the vehicles, make sure everybody's there. We'll get into the airport, and we'll get a site that we're gonna set up the mast. We'll go and scope out a site. Once we get our mast site all done, we'll bring out the trailer, we'll unload our expeditionary mast, and we'll start laying out cables and start putting stakes or screws into the ground to set up the mast. Then once that's done, we'll land the ship, we'll put them on the mast, and fuel it if we need to, and call it a day.
This flight is considered a cross-country flight, and two pilots will travel with the blimp and share the piloting duties.
Today we're leaving Carson. This will be the last time this airship leaves on a cross-country trip for the summer. In August, it's going to be decommissioned. But we're getting ready for the trip. They're disassembling the helium purification equipment. We've fueled it up, loaded up. Weather's looking pretty good today. And making our way in route to Santa Maria. I think it's about 6 hours. Weather's looking great, so should be hopefully a pretty smooth day.
With the airship ready to go, the crew start the engines. Matt will be the pilot flying the first leg, and he gives the command to release from the mast. Direction constantly shifting, the crew need to position themselves and the blimp to face into the wind. Today, the blimp will be performing a rolling takeoff, where the airship will, like an airplane, travel along the grass, gaining speed before becoming airborne due to the extra weight of the fuel. The flight capabilities of the Zeppelin NT will eliminate this step. Now that the Spirit of America is airborne, the ground crew will lower the mast and then gather up everything needed for remote operation of the airship. It'll take about an hour to pack everything up and begin the road trip to Santa Maria. Pilot in charge, Matthew St. John, talks about how he got into aviation.
I think I was like 5 years old. My dad took me up for an introductory lesson in a glider up in Tennessee. And it was ever since then, I remember just being ecstatic about it. I got to pull a little knob that unhooked the tow plane from the glider, and that was great. So ever since then, that's what I wanted to be. Someday I wanted to be a pilot. I used to do a lot of sailing too when I lived down in Florida, and I had a buddy of mine that, he knew me very well, and he's like, Matt, you love sailing and you love flying. You ever thought about getting into airships? And that's when my life took a right-hand turn when I least expected it, because it really did spark interest with me. And I started pursuing options. And when I first got called in for an interview, I was pretty excited about it. But being young and not having a whole lot of hours, I was still kind of nervous. You know, it wasn't a given thing. So it just so happened that the director of training at the time was a sailor, and so say 45 minutes in an interview, we were talking about sailboats, and it was his mentality that if you're a commercial pilot and you're familiar with sailing, that the training would come a lot easier with airships. That was my foot in the door. Then I got a phone call from one of the pilots at Goodyear, and he alerted me. He's like, there's a position open up, and we'd love to have you. You're already rated, and thought it'd be a good fit. I had to quit my job on a leap of faith and go interview with Goodyear, and it all worked out.
With the Spirit of America airborne, the crew now chases the blimp from the road. The vehicles can travel faster than the blimp, but are subject to traffic and the occasional bathroom break. But that isn't to say the crew doesn't have fun along the way. Once the ground crew arrives, Brandon talks to airport officials on where they can set up the mast. Every location is different and has different challenges that Brandon must take into account for the crew and the blimp, in addition to airport requirements. The blimp can be found circling overhead, waiting for the crew to install the mast. Depending on the ground conditions, this can range from 45 minutes to over 2 hours. Installing the stakes for the mast is a time-consuming process that the mobile mast truck for the NT will eliminate. While the crew sets up the mast, Matt takes us through his first job flying blimps.
It was called the Lightship Group. And they were an operator. Basically, they would lease out airships to different companies that wanted to use an airship for advertising. So that's where I got my initial training. I was on the road for 6 years, and you'll cross paths with other blimps from time to time. And I happened to cross paths with a Goodyear airship that was out in Phoenix. And just talking with one of the pilots, we kind of hit it off. And a couple of years went by. I traveled for so long that we were on the road 11 months out of the year, so it was pretty tough. It's definitely a younger person's job.
The crew will use jackhammers and custom-built tools to drive the stakes that keep the mast secure into the ground. Ground conditions dictate how quickly or slowly the stakes can be installed. Soft soil, and the stakes will go in quickly. Compacted soil, and it can take hours to complete the installation process. Tony Sanico, a 30-year veteran, is teaching the younger generation the process for installing the expeditionary mast for the GZ-20 blimp. When the Zeppelin NT joins the fleet, this manual process will no longer be needed. Even the pilots not flying help set up the mast as well.
All right, so what we're doing here is we're raising the mast, and this mast goes onto this base plate, and we have this about 2 foot long, 18 inches or so, stake that's connected down to the bottom of the mast. When we go to raise it up, we want to make sure that we raise it up evenly, because if we don't, we can snap that pin and that mast can fall down. So we have guys, what we call the mains, steadying it so it will go up straight, because that mast will have a tendency, as it's coming up, to want to lean one way or the other. And if that happens, it breaks that pin, and then we're kind of screwed.
I think the biggest challenge with managing PR for the blimp would be maintaining a balanced schedule.
Schedule changes. But it goes hand in hand with sports broadcasting. So, I mean, you just roll with the punches. And if it allows you to have days like this where you get to fly an American icon through the countryside, it's worth it. Well worth it. Days like today, where when you're in a cross country, especially in an area like this, we don't get out to very often. And there's a lot of stressors to the job, you know, or schedule changes, or you're dealing with weather. Days like today, where the scenery is constantly unfolding beneath you, it makes it all worthwhile. There's the reward right there.
Once the ship returns, we're gonna go out, we're gonna land the ship, and we're gonna put it onto the mast. We'll hook up our pennant cable, or the pull-in line, on it, and we'll have one guy pulling to help, you know, pull the ship in. Instead of a winch, we use a human winch.
Just loosen up your main, that's it.
The blimp, like any aircraft, lands into the wind to help slow it down. The crew is in a V formation, so the pilots can see the wind direction not just from the windsock, but by the direction the crew is lined up. As the airship touches down, the crew chief will direct the crew when to run out and grab the airship's lines. A second crew will grab onto the gondola and, in this specific case, begin guiding it to the mast. The winds in Santa Maria have kicked up, and Lorenzo, who is on mast duty, will have his work cut out for him today. His job is to guide the airship pin into the cup and lock it, securing the blimp to the mast. Brandon is directing the pilots to reverse thrust to slow the airship down, and the linesman to pull the blimp in the direction he's pointing, so Lorenzo can secure the blimp to the mast. In addition to the linesman, the crew holding the gondola can help the linesman by pushing and pulling the ship in the direction needed. Lorenzo successfully locks the ship to the mast, and Brandon gives the hand signal the blimp is on. Once the pilot confirms to the ground crew the engines are switched off, the ground crew brings and installs all the support equipment needed to keep the blimp safe on the mast. The external fuel tank is removed because the blimp will remain in Santa Maria for a few days. At the end of every day, a crew meeting occurs, summarizing the events and going over any issues of concern. For many, dinner and a good night's sleep are in order. One of the crewmen is on pressure watch. That is someone who stays with the airship all night long in case of any issues or emergencies. The mechanics are performing pre-flight, while the rest of the crew is having breakfast and getting ready for the day ahead. Other members, like Chief Airship Engineer Steve Dean, are having a bit of fun playing practical jokes on each other.
He doesn't know what's going
on. The intended victim being Tim. You could say that the crew are like friends and family.
He's laughing.
Morning, Tim.
All right, get over here.
With the crew assembled, it's time to drive everyone out to the blimp to get the day started. Carlos Marquez, Assistant Chief Mechanic for the blimp, will take us through pre-flight today.
Now I'm going to check if the scoop blowers are doing their thing. So we activate the blowers, and there's each toggle is looking at the micro switch. Start getting loud. Alright, testing, 1, 2, testing. Testing, 1, 2, testing.
Carlos will test every component and function of the airship, ensuring the airship is ready to fly.
We normally do full power, but I don't want to do full power reverse here. There's a lot of rocks on the ground. I don't want to kick the rocks up into the ship. All right, so everything checks out. We're good.
As Carlos finishes pre-flight, Matt will hold the morning meeting with the crew, going over the schedule for the day.
Weather is kind of like yesterday. Wind should shift around out of the west. This afternoon, blowing about 12. It's going to be hot today.
Now that pre-flight is done, the crew prepares for the first flight of the day.
Great when the ship's on the other side, you just walk right up, but when it's on this side, you gotta get underneath it and crawl to the other side.
Passengers are shuttled on and off the blimp out in the field for each flight. There is no terminal, nor a way to show a safety video on location, and thus the pilot for the upcoming flight will brief the passengers on safety. The winds at Santa Maria slow the blimp down and make running the lines less strenuous. But this isn't always the case. More often than not, the linesmen get one hell of a workout running to get the lines and holding the blimp in position. This will change with the Zeppelin NT, which can hover in position like a helicopter, eliminating the need for linesmen. The crew that work on and around the gondola are referred to as the car party. Two members are responsible for the ladder and helping passengers on and off. The rest of the crew will hold onto the gondola to provide stability and extra weight while on the ground. The pilot will shut down the right engine, and only then is the door open for passengers. To keep the airship from becoming too light while off the mast, for every two passengers that get off, two passengers are brought on board until all passengers have changed over. The car party keep their eyes on the crew chief at all times, who will direct them based on wind shift, directional changes, and in this case, to pull down on the gondola, adding weight as passengers climb on and off during the switch out. This too will no longer be necessary as the NT can hover in position. Finally, the pilot on board will start the right side engine and then switch out of the seat with the new pilot for the flight. The NT has a dual pilot configuration, and pilots will no longer need to change between flights. Once the door is closed, the crew chief will call for a weigh-off where the gondola is lifted but still held onto by the car party. If it's too light, more ballast will be added into the shot compartment. If too heavy, bags will be removed. When ready, the crew chief gives the thumbs up to lift the blimp, and then thumbs down to bounce the blimp into the air for takeoff. This bounce gives the airship enough altitude to power up and begin climbing in altitude with minimal risk of hitting the rear tail fin on the ground. The Zeppelin NT will no longer require the bounce to become airborne.
And then, like he was saying, the mains, just leave them on the same way. That way, when the mast goes back up, we don't have to readjust.
After the departure of the first flight, the crew will lower the mast. In between flights, light shop work or lunch breaks will be taken by the crew.
What's up, Goodyear Blimp followers? Welcome to day 3 of spring summer tour. Hashtag Goodyear, hashtag airship operation, hashtag Blimp Tavern. Woo! Pause. Hashtag I ate Mexican food.
Well, we went to a pretty good place, El Matador.
El Matador.
We figured it'd be good because there's Mexican people in there.
Yeah, I saw for your room service.
It's like going to Chinese. You don't want to eat Chinese if there's no Chinese people in there.
You know, you see the airship flying, you see it on TV, you see it off the freeway, and that's just the small portion of it, you know. The backbone of the ship is the crew.
Yeah, you know, we're a motley assortment of people from different backgrounds that come together. And
that's involved.
How you doing? My name is Antonio Sinico Jr.
Hi, my name is Erwin Cabote.
My name is Carlos Marquez.
My name is Luis Navarro.
My name is Brandon Chalman.
I became a rigger.
I've been working as a senior mechanic here.
Duties is to work lines.
I'm the ground crew operations manager.
Actually, chief electronic solution.
I've been doing mechanic.
Structural cables, rudder cables, major control cables, minor control cables.
I've been working for Goodyear for about actually a year.
I've been working with Goodyear for about 7 years almost.
10, 11 years or so.
You know, I'm going on 12 years myself.
I guess we'll be 19 years.
How long have I been here? 27 years.
30 years this August. I started in 1985. It's been great.
You know, traveling with us right now, we have 21 people going with us, and we're going to be gone for a month.
Months at a time, weeks at a time, you know, everybody here is like one big family.
It's a smaller group. Same people that come around each other. We see each other more than our families.
When we travel, it's fun. You know, you get to hang out with your coworkers. You know, sometimes it feels like you're just hanging out with the family.
The people I work with, got a great group of guys. It's always fun to work with your friends.
Exactly.
You know, each other's well-being, their personal lives. I mean, you just, you know, you care. You know, if something's affecting them in their personal life, and And over here, I mean, you do genuinely care about, you know, what's happening with them at work, after work, you know.
Dinners at night with each other.
See each other when we go back to the hotel. We eat together, but that's what's great. You know, you can't get that anywhere else.
And these guys that we are with, we see them more than we see our regular families. Especially even out, you know, just working, you know, because our job is so demanding. But these guys that we travel with, I mean, they're like family. We have guys who've been here for 30 plus years.
We've developed that relationship to where there's no tiptoeing around anybody's personalities or anything. If you need any help with anything, you feel free to ask.
Everybody gets along, everybody jokes around. You know, like one big family, there's, you know, little arguments here and there, you know. But in the end of the day, we get the job done and enjoy what we do.
We all have a vested interest in the success of the airship. I mean, it takes care of us and we take care of it. So I think with that common goal, that also helps bring us together.
We know how to work with each other to the point where we don't have to say stuff. People just automatically, oh, he's going over here, I better help him with that. Oh, he's going over here, I better help him with that. You know.
Get to come out here and hang out in the open doors, work with your friends, work with a great icon like this.
No, it's not for everybody, that's for sure. You know?
No, it takes a special person.
Yeah. It's a special, you know, we say it's a breed of person to be able to do what we do. You know, not everybody can handle the traveling or the close quarters we're all in, I mean.
But it's just, you know, it's just like one big family, you know. You eat with these guys, you stay at the hotel with these guys. I mean, you're with them all the time. And so I feel like they are, you know, a part of my family, you know, which is something you don't get anywhere else.
It's the team I work with that makes it so fun. I like every single person I work with.
Sometimes you don't get the time off, but other than that, I mean, we land a blimp for 10 minutes, we go back, sit down, do some shop work, hang out, BS around the shop sometimes. Can't beat it.
He's been getting a little cocky lately. Ever since he grew that beard, you know, that's like, stoic.
That's probably like 4 years after I got here.
1,000-yard stare.
There's usually the vodka blimps over there on the other side, yeah. Usually I have two blimps out here.
So I gotta get the anger.
It's like, hey, hold the goat.
You know, we used to have baseball tournaments back in the day when I first started, and we actually had a trophy. And whenever we meet up with another blimp crew, we go out, hit some balls, play some softball. We pass the trophy around, and you know, it was MetLife, Budweiser. What else was it? There's another ship. Forget the other ship, but there were like three or four of us going. The trophy would be passed around everywhere. It was pretty cool back then. Get together afterwards, have a few beers, you know, talk blimp stories. It was pretty cool back then.
That called me up and said, we just had one of our training pilots leave in California. Are you still interested? I said, heck yeah. So, got out to LA for an interview, and I guess as they say, the rest is history. The main thing is I really like the seat of the pants flying. I tell people I was born in the wrong decade. I like, this is as seat of the pants as it gets. As soon as you come off that mast, you're flying it until you put it back on it. Even in the hands of the crew, most of the time. Use the views and the ever-changing flying. It's never the same one day to the next. No takeoff and landing is ever the same in one of these. It started as a young boy in England. Moved to the States in the late 80s from England, and you know, I saw a lot of 747s and the Concorde, flew in and out of London a lot. And that's what initially sparked the interest. I got to visit the cockpit of the 747, British Airways jet, and got a little logbook. Captain signed it, and he'd do that for all the flights. Back when you could visit the cockpit, got a little British Airways Sky Flyers Club pin, which I still have. Still have a logbook. That's what sparked it. Profession, and that's the only thing we ever complain about is the schedule sometimes. It's tough, it's ever-changing. One of those jobs where, similar to broadcasting, you know, our schedule will depend on how well the sports team does.
During passenger flights, the crew keep themselves busy to pass the time. The Spirit of America returns from another passenger flight. And what better review than hearing from the passengers themselves?
We went down over the ocean, and yeah, it was like everywhere you looked was blue.
Yeah,
straight up
rubber rocket.
Fun. That's
about 30 degrees on those pitch up, but that was pretty fun. It'll climb. You don't have to worry about stalling out because no wheels.
Yeah, man.
So you just pull it all the way back, and
that was unexpected, but really, really cool.
Yeah, when I was 3 years old, the Mayflower came to Bakersfield, and my mom took me out there to see it. She said I ask every day to go see it. Wow. So I've been somewhat a fan of the Blimp since then.
With the last passenger flight of the day completed, the Blimp lands and will be secured on the mast before passengers disembark. PR is a large part of the Goodyear Blimp's roles, and today, in partnership with the Boys and Girls Club of Santa Maria, guests will be given a tour of the Spirit of America by the crew.
Go. Now, this is the best part of the job, is getting the people that don't actually get a chance to see it up close. Kids are excited, parents are excited. It's the fun part of the job. Makes it enjoyable to work here.
It's like boarding a boat. Have you boarded a boat before?
Yes. You know, and people don't attract to get to see the ship. They get excited, they want to come out and see it. They're on the fence line waving at us, so we go hand out brochures and show them and talk to them about it and ask them questions about it. It's a fun part of the job. It's part of the job, doing PR.
Oh, did you?
We park right there to watch it because we live right here. She's like, Dad, I want to go on there. And I'm like, there's no way I can make that happen. How am I going to make that happen?
Dad's an awesome guy, but I don't know how awesome you can do that.
This is me right here.
Wow. Yeah, that was me and my brother, sister, mom, and dad.
Oh, so cool.
Yeah, so my brother, he's 45, and he's in the stroller right here. So that was about 45 years ago.
Oh, my God.
That's crazy. That's
a wow. Yeah. This picture used to hang in the airport for years. My dad used to take us in there all the time and show it to us.
The Blimp has fans all over, but it's even more special when there's a very personal connection.
So I'm hoping to take the pictures that you just took and blow it up just like this and have one with my family, the same as my dad did.
That is so cool. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for letting us.
You know, I made 12 phone calls and I every building over there before I finally got out.
Before the crew heads back to the hotel at the conclusion of the day, measurements for future Goodyear Zeppelin NT operations take place at each airport the Spirit of America will stop over during the trip.
My compass to get each degree. That was 330 degrees going that way. So next one is 300, and then we're going to do each degree.
Okay, so all around the
all way around the mask. Cool. I don't know how to tell you. Brandon explained it to you.
We're surveying
the field for the NT ship, making measurements, making sure the ship could fit in this airport. Taking different measurements so that we don't have a 3-degree angle on each spot. So we're surveying all the way around, make sure that the new ship will fit in here.
After 4 nights, the crew checks out of the hotel and prepares for the cross-country trip up to Livermore, California.
So today we're in Santa Maria. We're up on our way to Livermore. And on trips like this, I try to document what the crew is doing so we can use it for different content, social media. We'll share it online with our Facebook fans. They like to know where the Blimp's going, when it's going to be overhead, whether we're going to the next town over. We have people posting, asking, hey, when are you coming here? So this gives us an opportunity to share it with them.
Kristen and Taylor will be piloting the Spirit of America today. The expected time in the air will be just over 8 hours.
Almost 10 years. have to learn about what the blimp does in the air, and then you also have to learn about how the crew travels on the ground.
Texas, it's flat. And then all the signs that you pass are, you know, Jesus died for our sins, you know, you're going to hell, repent, repent, and it's just signage after signage after signage.
As the blimp cruises towards Livermore, the ground crew is en route, passing the time during the long drive.
Okay, so I do like working as a team with blimps. I think that's super fun. I get to see some really cool things. Your schedule's different, so while you're actually at work, it's nice because you change up every day. So those are the things I do love about my job.
Heard the news story last night. Sorry to hear she's going away.
No, we're getting a newer ship, and then we're getting a whole new model in a year and a half. So we're actually super excited. The new model's going to be awesome.
Oh, great. We'll look forward to it. Thanks.
Cool.
The crew takes breaks on the road, stopping for both fuel and bathroom, as well as lunch. But with a 5 to 7 hour drive, there's a lot of time to pass on the road. Crew members trade off on driving duties. Some listen to music, take naps, read books, or engage in social media. During a cross-country flight, the pilots must transfer fuel from the reserve tank into the main fuel tanks.
I had seen it. I worked at Santa Monica Airport for a couple of years and had seen the blimp come in and out. I even have pictures on my phone of the blimp coming, doing a low approach and just thinking of how cool it was, but never dreaming that I would get a chance to fly it. It just didn't seem like, there's such a small market for it. Flying is a lot of fun. It's scenic, it's generally peaceful, it's got a little bit of excitement added into it. And I was one of two certified female blimp pilots in the United States.
Oh.
So me and Kristen are the two in the United States that are the operating blimp female.
I don't even remember the numbers, I forgot. There's like 100 and something astronauts in training. They're airship here or there, so there's just not a lot of blimp pilots. There's not a lot of blimps. They're hard and expensive to run.
The schedule is opposite of almost everybody else in the nation, though. Everybody works the 9-to-5 Monday through Friday job, where we don't do that. So even on a regular basis, you don't see your significant other a couple days a week, because they'll go to work early and get off at 4 or 5, and you'll go in at 4 to cover a sporting event or something like that. Or maybe you work on a Saturday, so you really only get one day a week, or sometimes not even that. We're ladies, but guys can like turn around, you can just unzip your pants and you're like still fully clothed. Whereas women have to like pull off your whole bottom half, you know? And I know that's...
It's
we're close, you know, but...
That's why I like the job so much, is because we have a family-like atmosphere. Everyone helps each other. I mean, if you see someone struggling, you don't just walk by. You stop and you help, and you don't just like lift a finger, you give a hand in whatever they need.
Every person has a very carefully integrated part, a role, in the operation of the blimp. And it's like playing an organized sport where every individual is crucial for the success. And we don't take that for granted. I mean, even the person that's on watch at midnight, you know, has a very important role. So there is no real weakest link. We're all a very, like, solid, strong chain.
With the blimp overhead, the ground crew arrives and begins to set up the mast. This also means Kristen and Taylor will be in the air at least another hour while the mast is set up. When the NT is in operation on the West Coast, the mast truck will simply drive onto the airfield. With the mast up, the crew is now ready to land the blimp. The crew arrives at the hotel, their home for the next 4 days in Livermore. Matt and Bill study the weather reports for tomorrow, while Tony and the rest of the ground crew relax at dinner.
What's up, Bay Area? Welcome to Blimp TV, day 5, summer tour.
It's currently 10 a.m. here in beautiful Livermore, California. I'm here out in the airship doing a pre-flight inspection. You know, it's a mechanic's courtesy to kind of just do the pre-flight for the pilots. So when the pilots come out here, we're ready to rock. Just in a nutshell, you know, pre-flight, we're just checking for anything that's out of order, anything that's misplaced. There's a sort of symmetry to the whole airship. So, you know, something that's out of place will stick out like a sore thumb. Okay, so we've got a total of 5 fuel drains. And the purpose of this is to ensure that there's no water in our fuel systems. Because as everyone knows, water is heavier than fuel. And the water would tend to kind of gather at the lowest points of the fuel system, which would be these 5 points. All right, so we're in the clear. No water. Now that that's all wrapped up, I'm gonna go ahead and give the blimp a whole lap around. Walk a whole lap around the blimp with my trusty binoculars and just visually inspect anything and everything, ensuring that everything is airworthy. And by the time that the crew arrives, the ship is gonna be ready to fly. I'm scanning the entire blimp from top to bottom. Okay, so now I'll just work my way to the backside. It'll give me a good view of all the cables, how they're run, make sure no pulleys are jumped. We'll also check the condition of the American flag that flies proudly behind our airship. Just a quick visual inspection here. Okay, so at the same time, making my way across the car, I'm checking that all my handrails are secure, because we'll have the crewmen hanging off of these and putting a great amount of weight on them. Checking the condition of my landing gear bungees.
Priscilla is already receiving passengers for the first flight out, and Matt will drive the passengers from the terminal over to the field where the passengers will board. This will go on most of the day.
We'll walk up in a real tight group. We're going to stay close together as we walk up there.
I like the heat, but this one is the
heat. Now this is on the final approach. It's really important that we all pay attention, because anything can happen. I mean, this is one of the most crucial parts of the landing. Ship can come in too fast, or you can get a wind shift, hit with a whirlwind. We just have to be on our toes.
Up, he's ready to take off. One of the dangers to the blimp is whirlwinds, unexpected wind gusts that can be very extreme and push the ship up or slam it down in a matter of seconds. To avoid injuring the crew, passengers, or risking damage to the blimp, the crew has to be aware at all times of the wind direction, near and where the airship approaches.
And whirlwinds just end up popping out of nowhere.
Yeah. Hey, look, it's going to pop right there. See it? Right in front of us. See the grass? Yeah, they're going towards the truck. That was, ooh!
Hey. Well, let me know when it clears. See, you can come in to land.
Whoa.
Hold them.
This job, it's never quite the same. It's never quite routine. It's always something different. But the ship, it's kind of like it's almost organic, like a living thing. You look at it and you can kind of tell what needs to get addressed just by kind of looking at the way the ship might sit or the way the ship's been responding. Right. The helium starts losing its lifting abilities. So after a while, crew chief or the pilot in charge decides we'll start purifying and we'll actually suck helium out from the belly of the ship. Run it through a machine that'll heat the helium, dry the helium, and filter out any impurities and any moisture that will pump it back into the nose of the ship, and we'll clean the helium that way. And when we do that in the process, we also lose helium too, so we'll shoot some more helium into the ship. So it's we're constantly adding helium and cleaning.
Right now, you know, the airship's on its last leg, and it's supposed to be decommissioned in August. Well, we did a balloon inspection. The purity was dropping on our trip, dropping about half percentage point a day, which is a lot for us. And they rented a lift locally, went up inside it, took a look at the aft balloon. It's gotten pretty worn. Anywhere there's a crease inside there is starting to kind of deteriorate. So air is leaking into the helium, making it less pure. And the right now the concern is that, you know, if we get some really severe turbulence, it might do some more chafing internally, and that ballonet opened up even more. And you do run the risk of, if it opens up, all the air that's in that ballonet is going to go into the helium chamber. And if that happens, you're going to get really nose heavy because all the air is still going to be left in the forward ballonet, and all the air is going to be gone out of the rear one. So we want to fly two pilots for a while, until we get this thing into a hangar. That way, one pilot can fly, and if you do have to do the air to helium rip provision, the second pilot can operate that. So it'll fly just fine. It's just once we get on the ground, we'll have to the helium will be contaminated. You'd have to deflate the ship.
The crew finishes their breakfast before heading out to prepare the blimp for aerial coverage of the U.S. Open tournament being held in Chambers Bay, Washington, on Father's Day. This marks the first U.S. Open tournament played in the Pacific Northwest, and the Spirit of America was there to provide aerial coverage to Fox Sports. The aerial camera will now be installed on the gondola. Mounted on a gyroscope, the camera will always provide a stable image regardless of any movement of the blimp in flight.
Good morning.
Anything attached to the exterior of the blimp must be secured using safety wire to prevent an object from falling from the blimp in flight if the primary mount fails.
We can only get 3 blimp hops for the entire time we're overhead, so they're pulling back from going 7.5 hour days to about 4 hours on air.
The crew has to be extra careful what they say in public to avoid something said being taken out of context, and a recent event works itself into the crew meeting.
Be careful what you say, because I guess somebody's posted something on our Twitter feed or something.
If you want more information, go to
that they have a video of one of us or some of the Goodyear employees saying that, you know, we haven't killed each other yet, or, you know, be careful when you're talking to people with phones and all that social stuff. Just watch yourself.
Tony explains the process for releasing the blimp from the mast.
I'm ready!
Letting our crew chief know that we're ready up on top. What we're gonna do here is pull the pin, push the button, and release the handle, and that'll let the ship unlock. Brandon's gonna give me the signal. There it is. Heads up, we're getting ready to come off the mast. Pull the pin, push the button, release it, and there she goes. Nose pennant cables pulling. Gets the hauling line pulled through. and we're gonna break it short today. Watch for break! Break!
The linesman will secure the lines to the gondola today to keep them out of view while the camera is in operation. This type of launch is called upship. Shortly after takeoff, the camera operator will lower the camera down beneath the gondola for a clear 360-degree unobstructed view for television coverage. The zoom capability, combined with the gyroscope for stability, allows objects very far away to be zoomed in with precision detail. The television station working with Goodyear will either have the director talk directly to the blimp camera operator on the shots they want at any given moment, or work through someone from Goodyear who will be on site at the event to direct the blimp camera operator on the shots needed. During lengthy aerial coverage flights, two pilots will trade flying duties on and off every 30 minutes. The cockpit of the Zeppelin NT makes this change unnecessary. There's a monitor in the cockpit control panel to allow the pilots to see what the camera sees, in case they need to maneuver the blimp to obtain the best shot possible. The NT has the ability to hover, giving an advantage over the GZ-20 for aerial coverage. 7 hours later, and the blimp is done for the day. Every airport is different, and for Shelton, Washington, the blimp lands in a field some way from the mast. The linesmen really have their work cut out, pulling this 12,000-pound aircraft across a rolling field approximately 300 yards away.
Lou's pulling out there as hard as he can. Get it to come in. I grab the nose, guide it in a little bit more. Get it inside the cup, lock it in place. Locked! Put the safety pin in. Pin is in! Power cable clear! Rip line clear! That's how old man does it, baby.
Like, said I want to kill you, Lou, on camera? That, remember we were talking
I think everybody's thinking about it like, did I say something?
Because I say horrible things to Lou sometimes. Yeah.
Sometimes.
He always instigates it, Tony. Always. I never instigate it.
What are you all huffing and puffing for?
Not us, that's new guy.
That new guy, huh? Yeah. Yeah, get him on the treadmill.
I want her on the lines.
With the blimp on the mast, the crew begins removing all of the aerial camera equipment.
Oh, watch the head.
Bump the head, boss. Bump the head.
That's great, man. Now we're going to have to start wearing helmets.
The Spirit of America is being fueled for its cross-country flight to Eugene, Oregon for a one-night stopover on its way to Sacramento, California for continuation of aerial golf coverage. With the heavy fuel load, Kristen and Taylor will be performing a rolling takeoff on the runway in order to obtain speed and lift the ship into the air. After the ship's departure, the crew begins disassembling the expeditionary mast. With the NT mast truck, the crew will be able to get on the road almost as quickly as the blimp takes off, eliminating the lengthy teardown of mobile equipment required for the GZ-20.
What up, Portman?
Notch.
This field sucks.
The crew isn't fond of the field at Eugene Airport. There's a large agricultural farm with very high grass, making it difficult to walk and maneuver the blimp.
Walking in snow knee-deep, you know, getting high steps. It's just such a hassle, you're putting up the mast.
Brandon works with airport officials on possible mast locations.
To minimize any time in the field. So we'll moor the ship on that concrete pad or that asphalt pad. We'll land you in the field, we'll launch you in the field. But they don't want any vehicles in the field, no blimps in the field or anything.
The crew has to navigate ditches and high grass to maneuver the airship to the mast. No easy feat. After dinner and a good night's rest, the blimp is airborne at 8 a.m. for the long flight to Arcata, California. Traveling over the lush forests of Oregon presents lots of beautiful scenery that can only be seen from the air. En route, the Coos Bay Airport radioed the blimp and asked if they could perform a low-pass flyby, which pilot Bill Bayless was happy to grant.
Would you prefer 2-2 or 1-3?
1-3 gives everybody a better shot to look at you, but it's whatever you want to do. 1-3 would be the preferable one.
No problem, we'll do 1-3.
That was beautiful. I sure appreciate it. Thanks a lot. You guys made our day for us.
It was an awesome experience. We love it. The weather's great.
Continuing down the coast with beautiful weather and scenery, occasionally the blimp was found chasing the ground crew. With unique atmospheric effects en route, the blimp came upon a dolphin stampede with hundreds of dolphins. The flight crew, while over the water, has seen it all, from flying fish off the Long Beach coast to dolphins, whales, sunfish, and the occasional great white shark, seen more frequently off the Manhattan Beach coast. As the blimp approaches its destination, it is determined the blimp is too light to get on the ground. In a very rare event, the pilots will have to dump helium to reduce lift and increase weight in order to land.
So we built up the pressure inside the envelope to above 2 inches. Now we're gonna pull it.
There you go, yeah.
Was it 15 pounds? A dual pull?
I think so. Well, more is gonna be better than not enough, right? So, either way.
I wait to get 2.5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
I'll follow you, TV man. I'll follow you.
We just made ourselves heavy.
Right.
As the blimp approaches for landing, Matt explains to airport personnel that you need some speed to have control of the blimp with the control surfaces. The NT will arrive and land nearly vertically, like a helicopter.
Yeah, the trick is you want to slow it down enough where they can pick you up because it's too fast. And people wave you off as they go around.
Right.
So you want to. The problem is if you slow down too much, you'll lose control of the control surface of the tail and the elevators of the rudder. So it's harder to hold the station.
Too much.
Before the next scheduled flight in the late morning, the mechanics will perform regularly scheduled maintenance to keep the blimp in top operating order.
He's completing a run-up of the engines, checking the magnetos and props, etc., making sure everything's working right. Everything's good. We're going to drain the oil now on the engines, change the oil, and complete our 50-hour inspection today. It's like working on your car while you drive.
While it's driving, yeah.
While it's rolling down the street. We're doing a 50-hour inspection today. We also do 100-hour inspections, which are a lot more in detail, spark plugs, windows, compression, a lot of other things. This is a basic inspection today and an oil change is what it is. This is an easy inspection. We're on a nice airport. We're not out in the grass in the woods, so it's quite easy today. I mean, it's nice and calm still. If it was windy right now, if it's blowing 15 or 20, we can't do it. We'll do it tonight. We do it in the middle of the night, whenever the wind dies down. When it's starting to pick up, you notice we're always moving. We constantly move. Constantly walking. And the ship kites up, we gotta be careful. If we're standing up here and it kites up and goes vertically, we can fall off. So we gotta jump inside or get off real quick, get all our stuff off. So we're looking for whirlwinds, keeping an eye on everything out here while we're working. These engines are relatively new. They got roughly 400 hours on them. They get changed every 1,500 hours. About once a year, we put a new engine on it.
Oh yeah. Plus I'm standing on my tippy toes trying to walk at the same time at work. Just kind of hard sometimes.
Bugs everywhere, sweat on my forehead, ooh, sweat down my back. Good Lord, welcome to Sacramento. This is what we live for.
With maintenance complete, the blimp is off to cover the golf tournament in Sacramento. At the conclusion, the airship will begin its journey back to Carson and into retirement. After 4 weeks on the road, the Spirit of America returns home from its last ever cross-country trip. The coming weeks will host a few more events, a public send-off party, and then off to the Tustin Hangars, where she'll be retired and dismantled. Goodyear hosted a VIP day, and guests included retired Goodyear Blimp pilots.
You old guys get like a discount on Hawaiian shirts?
I'm going to get back at 6.
Oh, I didn't hire you, Bob, but they talk good things.
I do miss you. I miss you guys, man. You don't even know.
It smells like aspirin cream.
Each pilot got a turn in the driver's seat one last time, and it quickly brought back memories.
Keep that up, I'm going to have to pee my pants. Yeah, you keep it up, you're going to shut off one engine.
Well, you're wearing the pants anyway, it doesn't matter.
See how you do that, Louie?
There you go.
Way to go, son.
All right.
I got a real pilot up there. Where do I go, boy? Way to go.
Four pilots took to the skies together and did flybys at Hawthorne Airport as well as Los Angeles International Airport, where onlookers were surprised to see the blimp cruising down the runway. Finally, the pilots switched out and took the entire ground crew up for a quick flight, making these the last official passenger flights. With Matt at the controls, he performed a very fast and low flyby, showing that while the blimp isn't a stunt aircraft, it can make for some exciting flying. With flying concluded, Tony guides the Spirit of America onto the mast for the very last time.
Actual
that's
last
it.
Pack flight.
Mags are up!
But the last official flight will be the one that
Monday
goes to the hangar.
Yeah.
That's the end of it.
This was the last PAX flight.
Last, yep, operating day.
Time for a nice cold IPA.
Yes, we had a like a baptism party for my son, and I went out and we had a bunch of people, so I bought just some cheap beer, and I can really tell.
All right, fresh pop.
Matt holds the last ever meeting for the Spirit of America, giving praise to the ship and the crew, and prepares them for the upcoming final days.
Get out of here. See you tomorrow. 10:30.
Yeah!
All right.
For the next 2 days, Goodyear had a very public farewell party for the Spirit of America. The general public was invited out to tour the airship, learn about the blimp, as well as activities for the children. It was a party atmosphere, even though what was to come was a very sad occasion for the crew.
Thanks for coming out here today and helping us celebrate the end of the Spirit of America. And even though it's the end of an era, the generation of airships, it's also going to be the beginning of new technology, the future that Goodyear is committed to keeping an airship out here in Southern California. We'd also like to thank the trash for teaching, even though our envelope is pretty expensive. I wouldn't consider it trash, but we definitely are very happy that they have decided to use the envelope, repurpose it for teaching. For
the pilots and crew were on hand to give personalized tours to attendees and answer any questions about the blimp. It was also an event to officially celebrate Tony Sonico's 30 years with Goodyear.
This is about every night.
Give him a napkin, he's crying. Tony's crying now.
But this crew that we have now, badass. I appreciate everything you guys do. That's a bad boy. Got my back. That's the song that I rest on, man. I appreciate it. Thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you, Tony.
On the morning of August 11th, it was overcast and cool. A somber send-off for what was going to happen once the Spirit of America arrived in Tustin. While the team meeting was occurring, Carlos Marquez was performing the very last pre-flight inspection for the Spirit of America.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Real quick, might as well just have this real quick. What we're going to go down and do is strip the car and the envelope. I got jobs lined up for everyone. Brandon and Ochoa are going to take the lower fin off. Lou, you're going to take all the envelope antennas off and car antennas off. The rest of the techs are going to pull a sign with all the temporary guys, and we're going to take that off. I'll explain that as we go. All the mechanics, Jim and Tim, we're going to pull the props, the engines, and the outriggers off right away. That's your job right away. We're going to strip it all down. If we can get it stripped down today or tomorrow, we'll pull the plug on it tomorrow afternoon or Wednesday morning.
The skies cleared, the day warmed up, and the blimp was prepared for its final takeoff.
Go, four light.
Roger that, four light.
You even checked your chain, didn't you?
Yeah, always do. Yeah, I'm always, Bruce has that story once Larry told me, but always check the chain.
Yep.
Leaving the mast in Carson for the very last time, the Spirit of America begins her final journey into retirement.
All right, here we go.
This last ever flight would be a one-way ticket for the Spirit of America. To mark the occasion, she would carry press for the one-way flight, along with Matt at the controls and Steve Dean, who helped build the Spirit of America. Immediately after takeoff, Matt circles back and performs one final high-speed, low-pass flyby as a send-off from the Spirit of America to her Carson crew.
Thank you.
crew is disassembling the mast, Matt takes his passengers and the Spirit of America on a final yet scenic flight along the coast.
You feel like you're rolling on an open ocean. Like, it's almost like you're riding on swells. And if you think about it, and you and I discussed earlier about it being similar to a submarine, in this case, you know, instead of water, our ocean is air.
What am I feeling right now?
Yeah.
I don't know. A little sad.
Sad. I feel like I don't. Like, I kind of don't believe it yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's sad. This becomes part of your life. I mean, everything you do revolves around this. You know, we've given everyone rides. President, you name them. They've all been in here.
Had a lot of smiles. Made a lot of happy memories.
Yep. I can tell you the most. He's the one up here in it. I just fix it for him. But look at all the places he's seen from the air. Got the best view in the house right now.
Yeah, it's incredible.
After circling overhead for about 40 minutes, the ground crew is ready to receive the Spirit of America for the very last time.
We're ready out there. We're going to land right in the middle of that field.
Roger that. We're ready for you. We got about 10, gusting at 15 at times, and we're lined up on wind.
Come on, Matt. Make it look good. The last time.
I bet you got a lot of cameras on
you. No pressure.
Even though she's been here before for regular maintenance, the Spirit of America does not want to land, for she knows this is the end of the line.
I don't think she wants to be here.
Nope. She doesn't want to go in that door over there.
The crew will be using the remote mast truck along with the linesman at the rear of the airship to guide the Spirit of America into the hangar.
That's it. Spirit of America signing off. Have a great night.
Team effort is required to move the blimp. Every crew member is on the lines pulling the ship so that it goes into the hangar quickly and smoothly while being pushed from the front by the mast truck.
Whoa. Whoa.
The hangar doors are closed, and the crew will arrive tomorrow morning to begin the disassembly process, which will take a total of 2 days.
Tony's, all right, I'm going to take the nose apart. Brandon's taking the tail apart. I need 6-8 guys on the tail and 6-8 guys on the nose.
Are we having fun yet?
Chuck! Yes! Cable cutters!
Sad day. Like, kicked one of the family out of the house.
I've seen him deflate the other way. This is a lot better.
Last time I did this was about 23 years ago.
Well, I've basically in the last 35 years have been involved in rebuilding all of them, so even a few times. So yeah, the sadness part, I'm sure. No doubt about it.
In the field, it's fast, quick, and simple. And here, it's slow and methodical.
The gondola will go back to Carson for cleanup, and then delivery in early 2016 to the museum for permanent display.
And I was telling Tony this, you know, maybe a lot of the young guys don't know this, but every part on the ship brings back a certain memory. Like a song that you listen to on the radio or something like that kind of takes you back to where you were when you first heard that song. So here, when you start taking it apart and finding different sections and stuff like that, it brings back a memory like, oh yeah, you know, I remember what I was doing when I was there at that time. So it's kind of cool, you know? So it's not really a sad thing. It's just like going through a photo album, you know, sort of fun, happy, you know? Like usually there's nothing here, like when you start going through things that there's like depressing, sad, or like, you're like, it's all pretty much positive memories, you know, which is kind of cool. You know, everything has just been pretty positive. So, I mean, for a lot, yeah, it's sad to see it like this, but you know, we'll get another one. They'll go on and make new memories.
So Brandon and I are actually two people that's ever done this.
Pain in the ass, let me tell you.
It was not the coolest
thing. But it came out nice.
It came out nice.
It is quite nice.
Here's one that's perfectly done.
Yeah, there's a perfect test patch.
No wrinkles, nothing. This is my first test patch that I've ever cut.
So you can see the other side, the hole that we cut out of the top of the blimp, when we're standing on top of it, you cut that section out. You put the patch on top of it, and then you put a cover patch over it. And this is like a beautiful one. No wrinkles, no puckers, no anything, potential leaks for helium. What had happened with that one is wasn't the greatest spot to work on.
From deflation to the final piece of the Spirit of America being loaded onto a truck, the entire process was completed in approximately 4 hours.
We did it for you once, and like I told Steve, we can't do it again. Have to take one, and that's all you get.
Well, the rain, in a way, it kind of sets the mood a little bit. Sitting in the cockpit here, it's just saying goodbye to the old ZZ20s and moving on to the next generation, which is great and fantastic, and we're really excited about it, but at the same time, you can't help it. You know, feel a little crestfallen about retiring the ZZ20. Well, as you can see, the biggest difference between the two, this one's more digital, computer-driven, fly-by-wire. The GZ20 model was a more kind of a mechanical analog type of airship, and this was much faster. It's got a lot more creature comfort. It's pretty smooth up, and they have a lot of more capability with it as well. But at the same time, you know, there's going to be some training that goes along with it. For us to become proficient in it, we have to spend a lot of time kind of relearning how to fly an airship. So. But we welcome that challenge and look forward to being captains for the new Goodyear NT.
The only thing that's the same is helium, but you can see it looks more like an Airbus. It's kind of an airline-style cockpit, ICAS, PFD, MFD, but there's no rudder pedals, so you don't see us really working as hard with the muscle movements, but it still feels like an airship. You know, you still have the seat of the pants, kind of instinctive type of flying. You can still feel, you know, basically, still feels like an airship.
In the GZ20, it was single pilot, so you had to be very self-reliant in here because there's a lot more systems. There are checklists that you have to follow, much like an airline, where whoever's in the left seat is usually the pilot in command, and whoever's in the right seat assists in flying, but is also responsible for checklists as well.
I definitely will miss the GZ20. It's very special to me. Personally, because I was the last pilot trained up on the GZ20 airship, so it's gonna miss that.
And we knew though that we were getting the very last GZ20, which kind of gives you a little bit of you know, consolation. And now knowing that we're gonna pull the plug on the very last GZ20 in 2017, that's it. We'll be the last ones that were trained in an aircraft that will no longer exist. It'll be sitting in a museum. So yeah, it's going to be a tough day to get through.
Nice.
the spirit of innovation arrives in Carson. This is the last of its kind. After nearly 100 years of designing and building airships, the GZ-20 will mark the end of an era. Goodyear will now operate a fleet of German-designed Zeppelin NT airships moving forward. The Goodyear blimps have flown everyone, from passengers and customers of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company to celebrities and athletes, even United States presidents.
Well, the weather is going to be a little marginal today, but days are numbered for the 20, and we have to take every opportunity available we can to get flight time. So time's a-wasting. Just spend as much time with her before it's all over.
Brian's got it down, baby. That's almost a blimp killer there.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
You're putting me on the spot.
What's wrong with your guys, Achola? They're lagging.
I'd like to introduce myself. Hello, my name is Dr. Green Thumb. We rolling?
So on a side note, we're making Brian work for his shots today. Since he doesn't want to come out with us anymore. He's becoming one of the crew guys.
Again?
Hi, I'm Antonio Sinico. Beep! Thanks.
Kenny, yell at him. Tell him to line up. They're not straight.
Hey, let's line up. Let's sit straight.
I want a sit-down meal. I want a salad, maybe a glass of wine, you know, ooh, nice red wine. Good steak, nice medium rare.
Nice! You're already the family, Brian. You don't even know it.